Thou changest not. Good morning, Trentside. So glad that you could join us again this Sunday. Before we go to prayer this morning, I have just a few announcements for you to be aware of. First off, for those of you in our youth ministry, those of you who are in grades 6 going into grade 12 this fall, the youth ministry has a great kickoff event coming on September the 11th at 4 p.m. at the Sparrow Hope Farm for you. Now, you're going to want to connect with Pastor Ryan for more details, or you can sign up on our church website for this event. Next, I'm excited to announce that our Blast Midweek Kids program is starting up in Bob Cajun on September the 22nd and in Fenland on the 23rd. We are looking forward to Blast this year and hope that you are too. Registration for Blast is now open, so go to our church website and get registered. Now, I am also excited to announce that Our Lady's Bible Study will be starting up on September the 14th at both our Bob Cajun and Fenland sites. There will be in-person and online groups this fall, and there will also be an evening group at both sites in the month of October. Now, you can sign up by calling the church office for this, and if you have any questions, feel free to connect with Julie Hayden. Now, lastly, for those of you who have been attending our outdoor services at Settlers Village in Bob Cajun, today is the final service there, but we are returning to indoor services in Bob Cajun next Sunday, and registration is open for those services now on our website. Well, praise the Lord, for there is lots to know and lots coming up, and it's good to see that so many things are being able to get started up again. So let's now come to the Lord in prayer, shall we? Would you bow your heads with me at this time? Heavenly Father, we give you thanks this morning, and we sing your praises. We praise you because you are exalted above all things. You alone show us steadfast love that never wavers and faithfulness that we can rely on. Nothing on earth begins to compare with you. Thank you for giving us your word. Thank you that in it we can learn the truth of who you are and what you've done for us and what we are called to do. We ask that you forgive us for the times that we have neglected to show love to others. Show us, Lord, the ways that we can show love to the unwanted, the mistreated, the helpless, just as you have shown undeserved, extravagant, and sacrificial love towards us when we were helpless in our sin. Cause your church to be known as a people who are compassionate, humble, and willing to help, whatever the cost. Lord, we pray for the teachers and those working in our schools as school begins this week. God, lift them up. Give them strength and wisdom. Lord, we pray for our children as they go back to school this week too, for this year ahead of them, as they learn new things. God, give them also opportunities to share your love and truth with others. We pray also this morning for all our different ministries as we look to them getting started again. And we give you praise that they are going to be starting again. We know that they are tools to help point people to you, Lord. May we honor you with our efforts. Lord, we pray for those who are dealing with sickness at this time. May they know that you are with them, that they are not alone. We pray for healing, Lord, for those who need it. And Heavenly Father, we also pray for Pastor Jeff now as he opens your word with us this morning. May you speak through him, and may we be open for how you want to challenge us by your words this morning. We pray, God, that you would receive our gifts this week. What we give is an expression of how much we love you. Take these gifts, God. Use them for your glory. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, good morning, folks. We're going to begin with scripture reading, and we've got a doozy this morning. Our reading is actually from the end of Ecclesiastes, chapter 12, verses 1 to 7. Remember also your Creator in the days of your youth, before the evil days come and the years draw near, when you will say, I have no delight in them. Before the sun and the light, the moon and the stars are darkened and clouds return after the rain. In the day that the watchmen of the house tremble and mighty men stoop, the grinding ones stand idle because they are few, and those who look through the windows grow dim and the doors on the street are shut, as the sound of the grinding mill is low, and one will arise at the sound of the bird, and all the daughters of song will sing softly. Furthermore, men are afraid of a high place and of terrors on the road. The almond tree blossoms, the grasshopper drags himself along, and the caperberry is ineffective. For man goes to his eternal home while mourners go out in the street. Remember him before the silver cord is broken and the golden bowl is crushed. The pitcher by the well is shattered and the wheel at the cistern is crushed. Then the dust will return to the earth as it was, and the spirit will return to God who gave it. This is the word of the Lord. Well, seeing it is the final long weekend of the summertime, Labor Day weekend, which is perhaps the most depressing of all the weekends in the year, you know, summer's final hurrah, the last day before the kids and teachers return to school, and the rest of us, whether we want to admit it or not, is the time we wave goodbye to that relaxed and carefree attitude of summer to once again return to the daily grind. And to add insult, we also start becoming aware that another Canadian winter is around the corner. So considering this, and also knowing this is our final Sunday in this summer series that we have called Words of Wisdom, I thought it only appropriate to preach on perhaps the most depressing subject possible. I'm talking about death. And even worse, to examine a passage that makes clear, not only will we all die, but for most of us, our years leading up to our demise are only going to get worse. So with this in mind, who is excited to be depressed this morning as we consider the impending joys of death and decay? Perfect. I knew you would all be thrilled. Now, before we jump into these peculiar verses that I just read, I do have to admit, I have always had a special fondness and fascination with this particular passage of Scripture. Because you see, I have this vague memory of this passage as a young kid. I remember growing up on this one Sunday and we had a guest speaker, and this was the passage he chose to preach on. And the passage really caught my attention. Now, it caught my attention because for the life of me, I could not make any heads or tails whatsoever of what this guest preacher was reading to us. I remember thinking, okay, preacher man, what are you going to do with these random ramblings? All I heard was something about grasshoppers and caperberries, almond blossoms, and busted up water pitchers. How would this preacher make any sense of these words? Now, hopefully I can help with that a little bit this morning. But let me first suggest this. This is the last little bit of the book of Ecclesiastes, and it's actually intended to be both humorous, we're intended to chuckle, haha, but it is also meant to be extremely serious. After all, a spoonful of sugar helps the medicine go down, the medicine go down. And the way I like to think of it is this way, is to picture an old man, you know, sitting on his rocking chair on his front porch, and he's there watching a couple young whippersnappers running and playing carefree on the lawn in front of him. And this old man, or the old teacher to be more literal with respect to the book of Ecclesiastes, he looks on with both a sense of foreboding and warning, but also a sense of jealousy to these young lives, as if these naive youngins have no idea just what's in store for them. You can almost hear this old, bitter old soul yell out to these unsuspecting kids, "Hey, you kids, put that ball down and come on over here. Take a seat, I got something to say to you." Now, what follows is basically this old man telling these young kids, "You better enjoy life now while you still can," because he's about to tell them what they will one day get to look forward to when they reach his mature old age. So kids, teens, be ready and be warned. And for us adults, and perhaps especially for those of us who are, or for those of you who are a little bit more mature, we may hear what this old man says about getting older, and we might begin thinking about two things. First, we'll think, "Yep, that sounds about right." Or second, "I ain't got that malady yet, but I guess it's one more thing I can look forward to. Oh joy." Well, with this in mind, let's dive in to Ecclesiastes chapter 12. Now, the old sage prefaces his amazing poem with these words in verse 1. "Remember also your creator in the days of your youth." Basically, he's saying, consider your creator before it's too late. Now, we will consider the statement in more detail later, but everything that follows is framed around this essential concern. Consider your Creator while you still can. Or as he describes it, before the evil days come and the years draw near, when you will say, I have no delight in them. Verse 1. Now here's a fun little tidbit. What are these evil days? Is it war, famine, pestilence, disease, you know, COVID-19? Worse, the evil days he's referring to are old age. Just listen to how the evil days of old age are described. Because really, this whole poem is a complaint about growing old. Let's look quickly through the joys of old age he shares to these naive kids and to us this morning. First, there is no delight day or night. He begins it this way. Before the sun and the light, the moon and the stars are darkened. Well, what is he saying here? Well, a little earlier in chapter 11, verses 7 to 8, he puts it this way. Light is sweet, and it pleases the eyes to see the sun. However many years anyone may live, let them enjoy them all. But let them remember the days of darkness, for there will be many. Meaning, day or night, there's going to be a time coming when it doesn't matter, because all days will seem dark and gloomy. He actually reiterates this with the next thing he says when he tells us the weather forecast will be constantly cloudy. He says, and clouds return after the rain. Think about it this way. The writer says this, and he's saying this while he is living in the Middle East, where there is very, very little rain. And I have been to Israel. Clouds are exceptionally rare. But in old age, it is sunny days that are rare. Now, I don't think he's not actually talking specifically about the weather, but more likely in his disposition of attitude. Sunny or not, you're still going to be grumpy, whatever the day. Now, we get to the fun part. All the physical ailments we get to look forward to in old age. First, we will go from strength to shakiness. Verse 3, in the day that the watchmen of the house tremble. These watchmen represent the strong arms that for years have provided the security for the home front. Sadly, the biceps now sag and the palsy sets in as these once strong arms shake without any warning. And these shaky hands are also joined by slumping shoulders and knobby knees, and mighty men stoop, again in verse 2, meaning the knees weaken and can no longer properly support our fragile frames, and to help with the strain, our shoulders slump forward to keep us upright. Well, what about our oral health? Well, the old man warns us about that too, because we'll soon be entering into our denture days. Listen to what he says next. The grinding ones stand idle because they are few. Back then, I doubt they had dentures or even blenders to turn our food into mush. Either way, there's no more biting into that mouth-watering delicious steak off the barbecue. Well, if there is any good news, the good news is this, that we won't be able to see very well all the good food we will be missing out on because we can no longer chew. Because next comes vanishing vision. And those who look through the windows grow dim. That kind of sounds a little like glaucoma. Even the strongest prescriptions and laser treatments can only correct so much. Not to worry, because the vanishing vision pairs very well with being hard of hearing. And the doors on the street are shut as the sound of the grinding mill is low, verse 4. The imagery here is we generally close doors to shut out noise. However, even with the doors wide open, we can now barely hear the sounds that are surrounding us. However, there is also a little bit of a funny irony. This old teacher points out, you would think with bad hearing, a person should at least finally be able to get a good night's sleep because you can't hear any of the distractions. But there is an exception. Despite being nearly deaf, get readied for unsettled sleeping, and one will arise at the sound of the bird. Well, when it comes to sleeping, ironically, any little sound will disturb you from your light slumber. So far, you lose your teeth, you lose your sight, you lose your hearing, and potentially, your voice also loses its volume. You don't have the same volume. And all the daughters of song will sing softly. You can no longer hit those high notes, and when you try to raise your voice, your throat bursts into coughing. Are you getting the point? Could it possibly get any worse? Well, they do say there are two types of people. There are those who are afraid of heights, things like roller coasters and cliff edges. And there are those of us who are fearless of such things. Sadly, Ecclesiastes tells us a day is coming when we will not only all be afraid of heights, we will even be cautious around things like curbs. It says this, furthermore, men are afraid of a high place and of terrors on the road. Tragically, one day we will become afraid of going out our front door because we can no longer manage all the risks that might be involved. Well, how about some more physical challenges and changes we can look forward to? How about the whitening of our whiskers? Verse 5, the almond tree blossoms. This refers to whatever hair we might still have left on the top of our heads is going to turn white. We are then reminded we will all become like aging locusts. Once so full of life, so full of bounce, now we drag ourselves along because we no longer have any spring in our step. The grasshopper drags himself along. Now, I know I'm going to get in trouble for this one, but please understand, this is the Bible saying it, not me. But apparently our steps will not be the only place where we will lose our spring, because we will have no success, even with something like Cialis, when it says this, and the caperberry is ineffective. Apparently the caperberry was considered the Viagra of its day, and I will do the wise thing and just leave it at that. Finally, these days of decay only lead in one direction that will ultimately be having us heading away in a hearse. For a man goes to his eternal home while mourners go about in the street. Verse 5. Then the old sage ends by going back right to where he started from. Verse 6. Remember him. Or to put it crudely, he begs for us to please, please, please consider our Creator before it's too late, before we croak. And I think as New Testament followers, I would not simply leave it as the Creator in a generic sense, but for us to consider Christ before it is too late. Again, listen to the rest of verse 6. Remember him before the silver cord is broken and the golden bowl is crushed, the pitcher by the well is shattered and the wheel at the cistern is crushed. Now, I will add this, as it is pretty humorous. There are some commentators who are actually suggesting the writer here is giving us one more physical reality as it relates to old age, specifically the loss of our control of our bladders. But I think that is pushing it a little too far, because we have already been told we are well on our way to our eternal home. The image here invokes the cord that holds the lamp of our life snaps and crashes. And the rope that draws the water that sustains our life from the well breaks, and the pottery pitcher which holds it shatters. Our life is over. Our light has been snuffed out. This is made all the more clear in the closing lines. When the dust will return to the earth as it was, and the spirit will return to God who gave it. Now, didn't I warn you? This was going to be such an uplifting message this morning, right? We got to save the best for last. But this being said, what was this teacher trying to tell the young kids he was speaking to so many centuries ago and telling us today? Yes, he was intending to be a little humorous, but his message couldn't be any more serious. In the same way, today I've tried to keep things a little light, but the message itself could not be any more serious. Here are the two things the teacher commands us to do. First, enjoy. Enjoy. This old man sitting on his front porch, looking at these young kids so full of life, wants them to know how good they got it at this moment. He wants them to cherish their life while they can, to not take for granted a single minute of it. He wants them to know in no uncertain terms what they enjoy today will not be possible tomorrow. So enjoy the gifts of youth while you can. Now, this is not often a popular message preached, especially in Baptist churches. After all, we excel far better in dealing out guilt than joy. But part one of the message of this old teacher is the command to enjoy, to cherish life while we can. Again, he tells us a little bit earlier, light is sweet, it pleases the eye to see the sun. However many years anyone may live, let them enjoy them all. But this is only one part of his message. This old bloke is not simply endorsing carefree living and hedonistic pursuits. Hardly. The second part of his message is far more important. He calls these young kids and us today to do is he calls us to embrace and to do it as early as we can. He commands us to remember your Creator when? In the days of our youth. We are to remember him when? Before the silver cord is broken, before it is too late. What he is calling us to embrace is not just to enjoy life while we can, but more importantly, to also embrace the harsh reality that we are all destined for decay, which will be followed by death. And only in embracing our Creator, only in considering Christ, will we make sense of either the joys of life and also the impending reality of death and eternity. Otherwise, the other option is to embrace futility. As he says, meaningless, meaningless, everything is meaningless. It is only when we consider our Creator, only when we accept Christ, will we be able to find meaning in this life and hope for the life to come. The old man concludes his book this way. Now all has been heard. Here is the conclusion of the matter. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the duty of all mankind. For God will bring every deed into judgment, including every hidden thing, whether it is good or evil. So please hear with me the words of wisdom from Proverbs 1 verse 7 again. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and instruction. Yes, enjoy, but much more importantly, embrace. Embrace Christ and embrace him while you still can, both for meaning and joy in this life and for hope in the dark days ahead and for all eternity afterwards. Remember your Creator in the days of your youth. Remember him today. Thank you.
shall be moved, and the power.